morning.
Sorry, I'm still trying to get organized here, I guess. Welcome on this fourth Sunday after Epiphany. I feel like I just blinked and January's pretty much gone already. It's hard to believe. I've been a little bit under the weather this week, so hopefully as I go through everything, I don't start a cough a little bit, but I'm feeling pretty good now. I've been better for a couple of days, but hopefully all the talking and singing doesn't get me coughing up here anyway. If I could turn your attention to the announcements, we'll go over those really quick. Wednesday morning at 8 a.m. is prayer meeting through Zoom, and at 3:30, Good News Club will resume. On Thursday at noon is the Senior Citizens Lunch down here in the basement. And Sharpsburg Bible Study will be at 3:15 Thursday. They are studying Genesis and John, it looks like. Also, I wanted to remind you that you can bring in your soup, canned goods, box goods, anything for the food pantry for Super Bowl Sunday. There's a table set up at the bottom of the stairs down there. So I think you can bring those in anytime up until Super Bowl Sunday. Tim and Gary and two people from the Corning Presbyterian Church are in Salvador, in El Salvador. They've been there this past week. And Tim will be returning here on Tuesday in case you need Tim for any reason. So, we have a guest here today that will be delivering our sermon to us, Amgad Beblawi, did I say that correctly? He's here and he is the presbyter for the Des Moines Presbytery, and he'll be telling a little bit more about himself during our minute for mission and then giving our sermon today. So, let us worship God. Cadence. Hold on, Kate, so you can help me with the call to worship. She will be our leader.
As God only said unto me,
let's go to the house of the Lord to worship there.
What better place to gather with others to praise God?
For us to confess and receive forgiveness.
We can seek God in the privacy of our homes.
What better place to the church to find God's people?
As God has said unto me,
let's go to the house of the Lord to worship there.
Join me in singing praises to God.
Please stand for our hymn of praise, page 7, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Thank you. when you walked the earth as Jesus. You called disciples unto yourself, and you prayed for their unity. Forgive us for creating and nurturing divisions. Help us to confess our lack of charity toward people whose customs are different or whose creeds conflict with what we believe. Forgive arrogance that claims to know God's truth. Forgive our failure to listen and learn from others. Heal us, we pray, and draw together your church in one faith, loyal to one Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. We have assurance of pardon and forgiveness in John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world be saved through him. So, in Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. You may turn to your neighbors and pass the peace. Okay, all the children are going to come forward for the children's message. Okay, you want to break me up, like. Okay. bill down to El Salvador. But when we bring our money to church and we put it up here in the offering plate, some of that money goes to help the different missions that Tim and other people go on. And that money provides them with anything that they might need that they're lacking. Okay, this is kind of old, but do you know what this is? Yep, it's a Bible. So not only do they go down and they bring them supplies, sometimes they will take them Bibles and they will talk about God with them as well. Okay.
Food.
Yep, sometimes they need food as well, so we'll take food to the people on mission trip. And what goes with food? Yep, water. A few years ago, didn't we provide tanks? Do you guys remember Rita and John? We provide tanks to people in El Salvador? I'm thinking we provided water tanks or something like that because they needed those to help healthy, clean water. Okay, we're almost done. Oh.
Vitamins.
It could be vitamins or any kind of medicine. Sometimes they're sick, and so they will take them medicine so that they can
be healthy.
And the last thing, what's in here? Yep, we got a toothbrush. We got some soap and a comb and a toothbrush, a toothpaste. Sometimes they just need things to help them stay clean and to keep their teeth clean so that they stay healthy. So these are all good things that we can take on a mission trip. Now, why do you think that we go clear to El Salvador on a mission trip? Couldn't we just mail those things? Well, we probably could mail them, but, you know, it's just nicer to go visit the people that live there, and that way they can see how they live, what kinds of needs they have, and see what they can provide them, and they become friends with them, too, and then they can help share the Word of God. So it's always best to go visit instead of just sending something in the mail. Okay, well, that is all I have for you guys this morning. I do have a treat, but I'm sorry I forgot to give you guys a coloring page. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Merciful and amazing God, you are the source of our being. It was you that formed us, named us, and first loved us with a love beyond our imagination. You know our needs and our prayers before we even say them, yet we find comfort in knowing that we can express our needs and the needs and desires of others to you. Through Christ and the Holy Spirit, you have brought love into this world so that we might know of your compassion, your peace, and your presence. We pray for our faith leaders as they seek to serve your people and connect others to you. Please care for Tim, Gary, Pete, and Jessica as they care for others in El Salvador. Provide them strength, peace, and safety. We also pray for the needs of the individuals mentioned today and those that we have not mentioned but hold in our hearts. We have so many concerns, O God, and at times they feel so heavy. We thank you for the opportunity to place them in your care and to rest. You continue to move in our lives, offering us moments of hope, joy, goodness, mercy, and compassion. Lord, we pray for Bobby, and we pray for Janine's cousin, Kathy. Mighty One, we lift our hearts to you as we pray the prayer you taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Remain seated as we sing our meditation hymn, I Love to Tell the Story, on page 463.
Thank you.
comes from you. We ask that you accept these gifts and use them to your glory. May these gifts bring comfort to the sick, rest to the weary, hope to the hopeless. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our first scripture reading today is from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit, not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the time or period that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We'll welcome Amgad up.
Well, I'm delighted to be back here with you. The last time I was here with you, I think it was either January or February 2020. So just a few weeks before we all went into a lockdown and COVID for a couple of years. But it's good to be back with you. When Tim asked me if I am available on January 29, I immediately said yes, because it's been a while. As is written in your bulletin, my title is Mission Presbyter, and what that means simply is that I am responsible for helping our congregations understand what mission is and being active in God's mission. So the message today is all about mission. Please read with me the second passage, our gospel reading for today. It's John chapter 20, verses 19 to 23. Listen to the word of God. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you, as the Father has sent me. Peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Reverend Erica McRae, who's the pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Independence, Iowa, brought to my attention this interesting story. The story is written by the famous Scottish theologian William Barclay in one of his books. So the story is his way of envisioning a conversation that took place in heaven after Jesus ended his time on earth and ascended to heaven. So you will not find this story in the Bible. This theologian was just imagining a conversation that took place. So Jesus had just gotten back to heaven, and clearly he was still bearing the signs of his crucifixion. So Gabriel, the angel Gabriel, sees Jesus, and so he comes to him and he says, "Lord, you must have suffered terribly for humanity down there." Jesus says to Gabriel, "Yes, I did." Gabriel says, "Well, at least now everyone knows about how much you love them and what you did for them." So Jesus replied, "I couldn't say everyone. In fact, at the moment, only a few people in Palestine know." Gabriel says, "Well, what's the plan for letting everyone know about it?" And Jesus replied, "I asked Peter and Mary Magdalene and Joanna and James and John and Andrew and a few other people to make it their life business to remember me and love me and to bask in my love for them and to show and tell others about what life looks like with me at its center and its foundation as its head, until all the world knows how I am, who I am, and what I desire. All of these people together, I will call my church." Gabriel looks skeptical, and he says to Jesus, "Well, that's all good and well, Lord. But what happens when Peter and Mary and the gang get tired? What happens when people start to forget? You know how short attention span humans have. What if people think you did what you did just for them? What's plan B?" Jesus replied, "There is no plan B. I'm counting on them." The passage, the gospel passage that I read, chapter 20, takes place on the first Sunday. Jesus had been crucified just 2 days earlier. Mary Magdalene gets up early in the morning and she runs to the tomb. She gets there, she finds the stone that had blocked the entrance to the tomb had been rolled away. She peeks inside, there's no body. She's saddened, and then she has a surprise encounter with the risen Jesus. Jesus tells her, "Don't hold on to me, go tell my brothers and sisters that I'm alive." So she runs back to the disciples and tells them, "I have seen the Lord." They don't believe her. They think she's hallucinating. Peter and John have to see for themselves. So they both dash to the tomb. And when they get there, they find, true enough, the stone had been rolled away. They go inside the tomb. There's no body. They don't see Jesus. They don't have the same encounter. So they go back to the house where the disciples were. And they locked the doors. They were afraid of the religious authorities, the chief priests and the scribes and the people who were responsible for the killing of Jesus. And the disciples had good reason to be afraid, because now that they killed their leader, those same people might come after. So It is in that room where the door locked, or the door's locked, and maybe even they blew out the candles or something because they did not want to be noticed. And then all of a sudden Jesus comes and he stands in the middle between them. And Jesus says to his disciples, "Peace be with you." Jesus is reminding them of what he had told them just a few days earlier. "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. In the world you face persecution. But take courage. I have conquered the world." Jesus had said this to the disciples just less than a week earlier. We find this in John's chapter 14, verse 16. So when Jesus says to his disciples, "Peace be with you," it's not just a greeting or an expression or a wish. He gives them peace and assurance of peace in spite of persecution, in spite of trouble and threat. The disciples rejoice when they see the Lord, and then peace. Jesus repeats it again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." Up to this point, the followers of Jesus were known as disciples. That's how the Gospels describe them, the disciples. They were not called apostles. But after this encounter is when the disciples begin to be described apostles. See, the word apostles in English doesn't mean anything because it's really a loan word from Greek. Translated properly, it means messengers, ones who are sent with a message. Let me explain. The Greek word used here is apostolon, from which we get the word apostle. So it's just a long word from Greek. But in Greek it means messengers or ones who have been sent with a message. So when Jesus says, "As the Father has sent me, I send you," the disciples' task now is to continue that mission that the Father started by sending Jesus. The message of God's love and saving grace is now the disciples' mission. Jesus entrusts the disciples, now apostles, with the gospel. So what do the disciples do when Jesus says to them, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you"? Do they all rush out the door to go and tell the world about Jesus? No. They stay behind closed doors because they are still afraid. Jesus has to appear to them for a period of about 40 days and teaches them again and again about the kingdom of God and what the kingdom of God is all about for about 40 days. And that's the passage we read in the first chapter of Acts, the book of Acts. That's what Christine read. So that first chapter says, after his resurrection, he appeared to the disciples over and over again for a period of about 40 days, teaching them about the kingdom of God. But they don't get it, because then that's what they ask Jesus, "Is that when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" Here he is talking about the kingdom of God, and they're thinking of an earthly kingdom. They're thinking of the good old days when Israel was independent and thriving as a nation. Jesus tells them, "No, it's not for you to know the times. But when you receive the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, you will receive power and you will be my witnesses." The disciples were weak and timid and afraid for good reason. It just wasn't in them to become apostles or to do the work of the apostles. Not until they receive the Holy Spirit. sure enough, when they received the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, that's when they now immediately start to do the work of the apostles. They are no longer afraid. We read about them in Acts chapter 2. They are not behind closed doors anymore. They actually leave this building and they go throughout Judea. First they start in Jerusalem where they were, and then they spread throughout Judea, and then they even go to hostile territories into Samaria. And they go as far as Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey, and Athens, and Corinth, all the way to the empire capital, to Rome, and beyond. And within just a couple of centuries, the church has gone to just about every corner of the world, to the ends of the world. And successive generations of disciples who become apostles, who become witnesses, make more disciples, who become apostles, witnesses, and make more disciples, who become ambassadors of the Son of God. The church is established in every nation on earth. The church has no boundaries. The church has no borders. The church is global. In the two passages we read, mission is defined very clearly. Many churches are very busy doing mission, but then when you ask each member, what is mission, you might get different answers. Did you know that the word mission is not in the New Testament? Nowhere. Read the New Testament in its entirety. You will not find the word mission. But mission is defined here in these two passages. Christ sends his disciples to do something. The task to be accomplished, the mission, belongs to the one who sends, the sender. So first the Father sends the Son, and in turn the Son sends us, his disciples. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. The mission is defined here as witness. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. The messenger, the worker, the witness, or the apostle is entrusted with the mission. Now the mission becomes ours to fulfill. So the mission ultimately belongs to God. It's God's mission. Our task is witness, to be witnesses, to fulfill that which Christ came here to begin. We know in the four Gospels that when Jesus called the disciples, they all left their vocations. Most of them were fishermen, so they had to leave their fishing boats, their households, their livelihoods, and the family, and to follow Jesus. And this could not have been an easy decision. We also know from the four Gospels that the disciples thought that Jesus would establish an earthly kingdom. Is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? The question they asked them again and again. But after 3 years of following him, and when they see that the religious authority managed to have Jesus killed in a public spectacle, any hope of an earthly kingdom is now gone. They realize, by this point, they understand that Jesus had a different plan, and it was not an earthly kingdom. The kingdom Jesus had been talking about is the kingdom of God. They were not going to be appointed as high positions in this kingdom. So that hope is now gone. But instead, Jesus now is sending them to the ends of the earth on a different kind of mission. And some of them will give their lives for this mission. And Jesus had warned them. So we read in each of the three Gospels, Matthew, Luke, and John, and Mark, but especially in Luke, it's repeated three times. We read when Jesus says to them, if anyone wants to be my follower, let him or her deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. And in fact, that's what they did. The disciples, when they became apostles, they took up their cross. Some were persecuted, some were even killed because of their witness to the risen Christ. And even today, many of the disciples who are apostles are persecuted, and to this day, many are killed because of their witness to the risen Christ. There's nothing ordinary about Christianity. God's love is unfathomable. The price that the Son of God has paid for us is mind-boggling. It is radical. And likewise, to be a follower of Jesus, to be a disciple, is a very serious commitment. So, brothers and sisters, you and I are Christians today because the first disciples answered Jesus' call and left the fishing boats and left their livelihood and lifestyle and became apostles, witnesses, and followed Jesus. If they hadn't done that, you and I would not have heard the gospel. You and I are here today because the early church and successive generations for the last 2,000 years of disciples who answered Christ's call to become witnesses, to become apostles, to be messengers. If they hadn't done that, you and I would not be Christians today. 300 years ago, when Presbyterians and Lutherans and Methodists and Episcopalians and Catholics came to the New World, came to this land, and established churches, they answered Christ's call to be witnesses. They understood their task, their mission, to be a continuation of Christ's mission. And if they hadn't done that, we wouldn't be here worshiping in this church today. Thanks be to God for the faithful Christians, disciples, witnesses, apostles, who handed down the faith to us. It is something that we celebrate and should celebrate more consciously, that we belong to the household of God, to this global network we call the church, the body of Christ. The Book of Order, which is part of our constitution as Presbyterians, the constitution that binds us together, the Book of Order describes the church this way. It says, the church is a community of witness, pointing beyond itself through work and word. Not just by word, but work and word. To the good news of God's transforming grace in Jesus Christ, its Lord. So brothers and sisters, there is no plan B. We are it. There's no other plan. We must be a community of witness, pointing beyond ourselves to Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you for your message, Amgad. Now, if you please join me in your bulletins for our creed. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing can